On October the 25th of 2012, I shot the following video up in the Blue Mountains with a fellow occult researcher. I'm going to blab on a bit, so if you want to cut to the video, go here. Now, I met this researcher at the Sydney Masonic Centre outside the archive room. He recognised me at the time and called me by my YouTube name. I was startled. I was a bit on edge at the time. This was during a period where I'd had these sort of revelations, if you will, about the occult and really, you know, the whole magic side of it and the astral side of it. I was on edge. Anyway, we talked for hours. As he pointed out at the end of those hours, I didn't give him my name the whole time. But anyway, later we sort of joined up and did a few things, and the following was one of them. Now, the information is his point of view. I'm not saying whether it's true or false, and I don't really care what you guys think in a way. It's a different perspective. This guy leads a very different life to most people, to the millions upon millions of people out there. He certainly does some different things in his life, as we all do, but some of the things are quite hardcore, and people would look down on some of the things that he's done. They are a little bit extraordinary. Indeed, he was at the Masonic Centre, and I do believe he was trying to find some research material from the archives. It may have been a paper that relates to Aboriginal hand signals, which may relate to Masonic hand signals. Because the Aboriginal society seemingly have a secretive society within that society also. For those people who don't live in Australia, there will be mention of Koris, which Koris are basically Aboriginal people, for your information. And enjoy the following interview. If you don't like it, just turn it off. The information is very abstract, I know that, and maybe very hard to swallow, and many people might just call it complete and utter mumbo jumbo. My guest has claimed to have astral vision. He does at times have some anti-Masonic tendencies, which I don't generally have. He also says that he's been part of magic ritual in the past also, and I would suggest does seem to have some knowledge in this regard. But anyway, enjoy it. If you don't enjoy it, please turn it off. Okay, fire away.
This is at Mount York. So a white fella's landed here in 1788, and it took a whole generation. I.e. it took at least one white fella to be born here that was conceived here, and that kid to grow up a bit. One whole psychic generation for the white fellas to be even able to cross up over the Blue Mountains. They were scared of the Blue Mountains, petrified. There's lots of stories between 1788 and 1810 of ghosts and scary stuff. They were scared of the Australian bush anyway, but those mountains, it took a long while to cross. And when they did cross the first time, three fellas, they got to here at this point, and then they looked out to the west, and they didn't go any further than here. They looked out to the west and saw that finally, after crossing the very rugged mountains, took them a few days. Even they had blackfella guides, but the blackfellas had took them a funny way, because they weren't from the tribe up here, so they went away a way that their tribe was allowed go. And they got to here and saw that there were habitable, farmable lands, and so they turned back. And here's this obelisk. an obelisk really locks in to this grid, because the journey that those three fellas and their white guides and their convict helpers came across along this road, it was now our current highway and railway and electric grid now follows. And we have important points along this ley line that's being manufactured by our civilization. We've manufactured a psychic ley line. We have at important nodal points the spirit of our culture has channeled through town planners, architects, councillors, decision makers, and through common workmen and folk. A group plan has been enacted through the spirit of our culture, and at nodal points these structures and edifices have been placed to hone in and spiral in the group energies of our civilization. So these edifices are they exist in multiple planes. We can quite see this the peeling paint of this old thing, which is going to be done up because it's actually the bicentenary of the crossing, or the centenary of the crossing, or for some big landmark happening at the end of the year, and this will be repainted in the next month or so. It's about to be done up, this monument. And next time you come here, it'll be white and gleaming. In fact, you can see it from all the way from Lithgow. You can see this monument for miles away. But this monument exists not only on the physical. Its actual shape of its architecture, this four-sided structure, actually is through the intent of all of the people, but especially through the intent of the spirit of the culture and of this civilization, this Australian civilization, this white fella civilization. Its intent has also built the structure in the astral and a structure in three other planes. So if you look at it carefully, you can see that actually there's a lot more to this structure. And it truly is bigger and has a very strong aura. If you look at the trees, you'll see a much more natural aura. And we're exploring today the spirit of the civilization and the order it brings, and the wild spirit of nature and the order it brings, and the similarities and the differences. We're discussing the four directions. And this edifice here is an edifice of the four directions. It's here on the most westerly point it was placed of our civilization at the time. It was placed to mark the western road. And today we're going to go to another natural place that imbues the spirit of the West. Here in Australia, along in the Blue Mountains here, all of our cold comes from the West. We've got a westerly breeze happening right now at us, coming at us. And it's a cold, tricky wind, the West. The energy of the West is it's the shaman's wind, where the northern energy is the energy of strength, and the eastern energy is the energy of order, and the southern energy is the energy of growth. Here, along this eastern-western conjunct, we have the energy of order manifesting and playing its game with the energy of the West, the tricky, cold, shaman, ghost energy. The West is the hidden energy, and the spirit of Australian civilization has really followed its growth along, first off, this east-west ley line. So we have an obelisk here, the four-sided edifice, and a pathway, and the pathway, at the end of the pathway, or the start of the pathway, we have a feminine portal, an arch, and all the structures we're exploring today have this in common. We have if we like, the portal there that is the first layer. When we enter that portal, we leave our physical behind and enter the first layer, the astral. And here we have this edifice in the astral. Now, the structure is multi-layered. It has in its physical form, it was actually the foundation stone of it was laid by Masons, and there was some conscious intent about the role of it even in the astral by the Masons at the time who consecrated the structure. But as we've discussed, there's no actual collusion. The portal gate, it was made independently with different people at different times from the obelisk structure. It is actually the spirit of the culture that has put all of these things in place and has set up this thing for ritual. But as I did say, the actual obelisk was consecrated by Masons, and some of the Masons at the time had some inkling of what's going on. Because the workings they've done gives them some access to channeling the cultural spirit that is the over architect of this structure. There is consciousness here, and if you look, just as there is the consciousness in the trees and in the shapes of the mountains, but here we see the order of civilization forming a much more crystalline structure. Okay, so we're here in the middle of a second degree pillar, and we see that there's four pillars around a perfect tombstone-like stone. Now, safe. It looks like eight pillars. You'd swear there are eight pillars, but in fact, what this structure is showing us is the secret pillar. We if you have a look down at the base of the pillar, we'll see that the secret pillar is like a channel of energy. It's a portal. The real pillar is a pillar like that. It's not a, and with the two physical pillars revealing the astral pillar, this structure is like a key for the big obelisk and portal structure that we examined at Mount York. This is like we're in the outer court. This is a sculptural representation. Now, I want to add that these structures and edifices that have been designed and built with only the collusion of the spirit of the culture and the spirit of the state, that spirit has built these structures for all of us. As a modern mage, as a modern shaman, we can use these signs and these places for our own workings. We can reinvent this, where those in the know in our Masonic type brethren have used these edifices to maintain the status quo. Us modern practitioners, we us of this new generation, we can use these edifices, these structures, to undermine the control systems that those old pillars of our society have fought to maintain. So really our job is to psychically take over, because these are a bunch of frail old men. With their, unfortunately for them, their system means that you don't even get to start to know it until you're a frail old man. We're young and in the know. We can, us urban modern shamans, we use these points for our own undertakings. We're working with the not the spirit of the civilization. We're working with those wild spirits out there that are building these other structures. We're bringing it all together in a new way. The spirit of this civilization, its paint's peeling and cracking, and it's happy. It's happy to succeed. I know that the spirit has led it. It's a nice spirit. It's not a nasty spirit. The spirit of our civilization has led itself to its own demise for us to take over. We're going to reinvent it. But with that, we'll be using as our ally that amazing wild spirit of nature. Because when we built these structures that we're standing in, our civilization, our Victorian Edwardian civilization, was in fear, and we felt like we had to block out nature. Now we can be a lot more wild, a lot less crystalline, because if we look at the spirit of nature, that's how the real magic works. Okay, we moved down the highway to Blackheath. Here we have a similar structural alignment to Mount York. We have a portal and an obelisk. Now, one key thing I want to point out is that the two structures, well, three if you count the pole, the pillar with a light in the middle, but the two main structures were conceived at different times and for different functions. One's a war memorial, one's a marker celebrating the journey of explorers along this road. So they're filled by different times, but the spirit of our culture, the spirit of civilization, has aligned these structures together. It has worked through all of the people and bodies involved with building the physical structures, because actually here the spirit of culture has built an astral edifice. It is a spot of power. In fact, this very spot is very close to an Aboriginal Bora ring used by the Gundungurra tribe. And so this Bora ring is still being subscribed by the spirit of our culture.
Can you describe a Bora ring, please?
A Bora ring is a place where local Aboriginals would do a ceremony, particularly a high initiation ceremony. And the Bora ring was like a Western occultist magic circle. It was a structure that was built by a mound and delineated the crossing of the physical to the astral. Now, this particular structure is aligned in the north and south. The portal is a portal of fire. The north represents fire and strength. The pillar is a pillar of growth, a pillar of the earth. It's in the south. The east represents order and air, and the west represents water and mystery. So this structure, as I have said, has no collusion amongst all of the actual physical people involved with building it, but it is a signature, and I use that word very deliberately, a signature of a particular spirit. And we saw the signature of the spirit up at Mount York. We'll go somewhere else where the same signature is now. Okay, so we're here in Govert Sleep, on our third spot in the Blue Mountains. We're right on the edge of a ravine, of an awesome spot. And here on the very edge of this ravine, we have another portal and obelisk, a four-sided obelisk. The only point of the obelisk is that it's four-sided. So we're talking about the ritual that half a sheep is espousing. So I'm showing how the spirit of culture is playing out this ritual with architecture. Now here on this edge of this awesome natural wild ravine, the spirit of civilization has placed its signature. We have the two pillars here, the two white pillars leading to the arch, the portal, the feminine principle, and then the masculine four-sided principle, the pyramid on a pillar, right through. We'll go through the portal now. So as we go through the portal, we pass through the two white pillars, through the portal, now we enter the sacred space. We can see we're in a circular form, a natural circle in the sacred space. In the in the psychic allegorical middle of the space, we have the obelisk. Now, I just want to quickly point out, in the space we have another key. This is showing the feminine principle in its four-sided aspect. It's like a well shape. We have a pillar and a plane and a four-sided coming together as a four-sided arch. Once again, like in the Mount York space, the key here, which is sort of in the outer court of the ceremony, shows the negative pillars. It shows the, which represents that the third band of that DNA. It shows that the vortex space, the negative space, is actually where the ceremony happens. It doesn't happen in the pillar, it happens in the spaces between. So here in our magic circle, we see what civilizations claim. It's claimed the little tiny tip on the edge of absolute divine awesomeness. I think civilization might be a little bit scared of how minuscule it is. I mean, why did someone on the edge of this amazing lookout need to build an obelisk and a portal? You know, it's not like tourists would be having a lesser experience if they didn't walk through a portal and encounter an obelisk before they encounter this awesomeness. But the spirit of the civilization, and particularly the spirit that has created the highway and the evolution of civilization in Australia up the highway into the Western Plains and farming, that spirit is once again a signature of that spirit, and the signature is showing the ceremony. The signature leads us into a sacred space that shows this four-sided ceremony. The next spot we're going to go, I want to show that how the wild nature is also playing the same four-sided story. While we're here, this one spot we will go, which is the spot we're going to explore, the Eastern magic. I'm pointing on the horizon there. You can see, and look, if we can zoom in a little bit. And go over this way. Now this flat thing, I'm moving my finger in so you can see it. This flat thing here is Flat Top. Now right on the edge, you can hardly see on this camera, is a tree. And right there in the saddle of the hill is one of the natural spots we're gonna go. Yeah, that's the spot. Just in there is where the spirit of the East, the air spirits, the spirit of order, has created a natural dome for that. For at least 4,000 year cycle, Aboriginal clever people, shaman, used to jump across this gully. Now we have this gully is, and in fact our portal and obelisk is once again set up in the north and south. The portal is in the south, the obelisk in this case is in the north, opposite to the one we saw on the highway. That in fact the big psychic ley line, we can see the valley is describing the ley line. Right through the valley there, I'm pointing now into the real north. I don't know if it's magnetic north or north on a map, but the psychic north of here is exactly that direction, at a mountain called Mount Yengo, which is for many Aboriginal tribes for at least 10,000 years, New South Wales tribes, is the most sacred mountain. And that shape of that mountain is a natural beehive shape, and there's a series of mountains in that same shape following this ley line along the north-south, culminating at Mount Yengo there, and deep in the south at Mount Kolong. That's showing a natural ley line. The ley line between Flat Rock and Hat Hill, which is this, where there's a portal of the west and a portal of the east, was used by clever shaman to lose their human form in order to have their astral body jump across this great ravine. They used the awesomeness and the natural occurring ley lines that were set up by the intention of the spirits of those directions in order for humans to participate in the beautiful natural energies and emanations of that ley line. This smaller ley line gets its energy from this greater ley line. The ley line that we build our civilization is an east-west one, and if you remotely view people when they dream, their astral bodies tend to follow that east-west direction, where if you look at Kuris around or people who are more in tune with nature around here, and if you intentionally align yourself up to the north-south ley line, then in fact your dreams will become a lot more freer, and you'll become more shamanic and aware. So we're here today in Blackheath at a location called Hat Hill. This place is imbued by the spirit of the western wind. We have here a portal that has been shaped and crafted by the spirit of the western wind. The intent of the western wind, maybe if we come in and have a look, we'll get blasted by the wind. It's a really strong wind here. The wind is always feels a little bit colder coming through the portal than anywhere else, because the spirit of the west is a colder energy. You can see if we look down here how the energy's been shaped, and if we look up, you see that there's actually two pillars leaning into each other, and the spirit of the west has intended this spot. If we look out to the east, we look through to Flat Top, which is another spot we're going to go, and there's a line in the world. There's an auric line in the world between that spot and this spot. And the spirit of the east and the spirit of the west, the spirit of order and the spirit of mystery have combined to create this line in the world, have created the dome of the east, and have created the portal of the west here, the portal of the western wind. The intentions of these energies have created this spot for man. These spots have been set up for man to use. And in fact, these two spots have been used by Aboriginals for over 10,000 years. In the last 4,000 year cycle, a particular group over on Flat Top is where they do a particular initiation. And then in the saddle of Flat Top, they do another special initiation for clever people or shaman about when they'd reach the age of 25. And that the initiation would be a losing of the human form. They'd go through the same ritual that Half a Sheep has been looking at, that the spirit of culture has been playing with. They would invoke the four directions, but particularly use the spirit of the east to, after they lose their form, their spirit of the east would bring them on the journey, and they would cross the filament in the world, cross this energy line in the world from that spot to this spot. The spirit of the west would anchor, here is the anchor of one end of that ley line, of that short filament in the world that has been designed by these two energies, the spirit of the west and the east, for this earth magic. Now we've been looking at the architecture of civilization and how those structures are reflecting the patterns. Here in the wild, the pattern isn't as crystalline, but the energy is a lot stronger. We can see how, if we look right out, we have Sydney over the horizon. We have a thin trail of civilization up the highway, and we have trig points and grid points that we just saw up on the hill. At all of the major points, the spirit of civilization has put a survey point and a grid point. That is how we've made our maps, but is also how our psychic energy has cast itself onto the landscape. When we look through the spirit of the land, it's a lot more rugged. The ley lines will cross vast ravines. You can see the trees are a lot more gnarled than any beautiful Egyptian style obelisk. That's the difference between the wild magic and the civilized magic. And we can see how at all the edges of the wilds around the Blue Mountains, the spirit of civilization has put its signature right on the edges. But I'm showing you here is the signature of the western wind. This is where the western wind has left its signature. We walk through the portal. It's a bit of a scramble. See below us how a ravine in the rock, how describing this, showing us, pointing our human eyes to the line that exists in the astral between that spot and this, and the portals showing us an opening into the world where that ley line exists. Throughout Australia, there's, in most regions, there are clever spots. The Kuris, the ancients, they knew about them. Their rituals revolved around these sacred spots, these amazing earth energies. The white fellas have been very scared by the primal spirits. White fellas are very scared when they can't control the elementals. Out here in the wilds, you're at the mercy of it all. You have to have complete faith. You have to have complete sacrifice. You get 100% burnt. The payoff is a lot more power. The wilds is where the power is. The occult, the Western occult schools are only on the fringes. They've been channeling this wild energy, putting it in a way that our human mind can understand. Out here in the true wilds, our mind, we just have to leave behind. Only our spirit can understand it when we engage in the real ritual.